Back with Robert Greenwald about the idea that we ought to rethink our position in Afghanistan. Of course, right now, I think my position is what I'm seeing happen with the 21,000 troops that have moved in is that maybe, hopefully it's given Obama and his advisors time to think about what they inherited. I mean, if you really think about it, that's what this guy's got to figure out. What in the hell did he inherit here? And it's not a pretty sight what he inherited, because I don't know there's a solution to this. I mean, especially if we rule out the obvious, and the obvious is that Pakistan is part of the biggest problem.
Well, he inherited just a disastrous policy, strategy, if you could call it that, an invasion of a country in the worst way, which makes his job even harder. I think that, again, he's got some brilliant people around him, and we will see some progress. But one of the other fascinating things when I was there, first of all, everybody has a relative or a cousin who's in the Taliban. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not like here. It's not like some strange alien force.
It's not like being a Republican here. You don't want to admit you have it. But anyway, sorry to digress here.
One of the many interviews I got, and it'll be in the subsequent film, subsequent sequences, was a former member of the Taliban who's in the Senate there now, as they call it. He's negotiating, and there are several negotiations going on which have tremendous possibilities and hope. Because the other, as you said in the beginning, 10,000-foot view is that this is a country that's been at war for 7 years, a terrible toll in terms of death, and it's a country among all sectors of society that wants the war and to stop, which is why I think there's an extraordinary opportunity for this change president to try changed policy.
I love your idea. First of all, it's really, if you think about it, Robert, it's more than 7 years. They've been in war. They've been at war, you know, they were at war with Soviet Union. Before then, they were at war with the British. Before then, the Macedonia. I mean, it just goes on forever.
Yeah.
It's just like everybody. You almost look at the photographs. And, of course, you were there. And the place looks like a moonscape because there's been so much bombing and destruction. It's almost like I remember Rumsfeld saying, that little freak. I remember him saying one time, why should we go to Afghanistan? Everything's been blown up. And did you get that impression when you were there? I mean, nothing there.
I mean, you go down, you go down streets, and there is, you know, bombed out building, deserted building, shot up building, right next to people living, as I said, in shacks, in huts, and right next to that, with 3, 4, 5 men with guns protecting some building, some property of some kind.
Mm. You started out by saying it makes more sense, really, to send in doctors and teachers and negotiators than it does 21,000 troops. I think back to Charlie Wilson's War, great little movie, and at the end of it, that's the message that I think was trying to be delivered is, okay, we've come here, we've rid this country of the Soviets. Now we have to rebuild in a way that they're going to be appreciative of. Right now, I don't see why they have any reason to be appreciative of the U.S. presence.
Well, we're not building. We're invading and
right.
We're occupying. We can say whatever we want, but it's 21,000 people with guns going into a country where we don't understand the language, we don't understand the culture, we're not part of the religion. That's an invasion. And if you're a nationalist organization like the Taliban, that feeds your belief system. That feeds the notion we must fight these devils. Now, we don't want to think of it that way. We don't want to see it that way. But damn it, we've had so many years of this purely military approach that we've got to start looking at the problems from another perspective.
What do we do? I mean, obviously the key, and I know Petraeus would want to do this if he could, and that would be the smallest number of troops to protect and to help in some way, form or fashion, the largest percentage of the population. And it doesn't sound like that's really going on right now. I think we're still in the airstrike, bomb them to hell, don't let them cross the border of Pakistan. I think we're kind of in that mode, aren't we?
Well, it's not clear to me what mode we're in militarily, But I think that we have to be very careful. I just reread The Best and the Brightest recently, that brilliant book about Vietnam.
Yeah.
And, you know, we were trying to do the same thing there. We were just going to send in enough troops to stabilize, secure, and protect the population so we could step back. Well, there's a kind of arrogance involved in that and a belief that we can do that, which, first of all, we have to evaluate. Second of all, do you make a country and a populace secure by invading and sending in troops? How about going the opposite way, which is trying to guarantee security by negotiating?
Well, the first thing that has to happen, though, isn't it that we have to at this point, nobody's even at the table. The chances of
No, they are.
Well, but they've been at this table before. I'm talking about how do you take all of this, these various tribes and these various groups, and put them at a table. What do you say to them to where they're going to say, okay, well, you know, we can live with our religion if you can live with yours. That's the you can't cross that line kind of problem, isn't it?
It's
coming down to fundamentalist versus the folks who say, you know, I don't think everybody should have to wear a headscarf. I don't think that we ought to be so strict from a religious standpoint. I mean, it is really a religious conflict more than anything. It's not a military conflict, is it?
Well, I think it's definitely not a military conflict. It's a conflict about many things. It's about power. It's about turf. Remember, again, the Pashtuns were the dominant control for many years. With their being Taliban, they want the control back. So you could look at it many ways. But the first question is, you asked before, why are we there? Are we there because of threats to U.S. security through terrorists, which means a focus on al-Qaeda? Are we there because some terrible things have been done by the Taliban, which is a different kind of campaign? But again, it's very important to know not only are negotiations going on, but some of the things you're talking about, some of the, you know, rights for women and how people dress, those things are being negotiated. There was a recent article, I think it was in the Independent or in Reuters, talking about the fact, and it was quoting one of the Taliban negotiators, essentially saying, yeah, those things are on the table. Because, again, years and years of fighting, there's a possibility of a negotiation. And if we put our brilliance and strength and energy and some of our dollars into supporting the local groups, the peace groups, the ground groups, and negotiations, we'd see a whole other thing over there.
Yeah, nuclear weapons in Pakistan has got to be one of the huge complicating factors right now. That's the scariest thing about the whole chain of events and the whole circumstance over there. That's the scariest thing to me.
Yes, well, it's absolutely scary. And in our second video called Rethink Afghanistan, Pakistan, Stephen Kinzer, former reporter from the New York Times, says it should be written on every diplomat's head, do nothing that will further destabilize Pakistan.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, we're sending predators into a country that we're not at war with, and we are killing people in that country. That is having a significant destabilizing effect on Pakistan.
Robert Greenwald, I can't wait to see your new film. When will it come out?
Well, you can go right now to rethinkafghanistan.com, see the first two sections, which is about one section about troops, one section about Pakistan. Send it to everybody you know. The third section around cost of war will be next week. And please sign the petition so that we can get 50,000 names so that we can have Senate hearings, not just you and I asking these questions.
Thanks a lot, Rob.
Okay. Take care.